six out of seven of us said that we wanted peace most of all. And the seventh said that they wanted joy because in her experience, peace follows when she finds joy in her life. So we were in that cluster there together. While one person expressed the desire for peace since so much of their life feels on hold right now, and I know many of you know what that's like, I said I wanted peace right now because everything in my life is going full throttle, and some of you know what that's like too. Just that morning of the staff meeting, I'd been wondering out loud with Leanne if we would even bother putting up a Christmas tree this year. That thought was quickly reciprocated by the 17-year-old in our house with one word, really? You know, the way the word really is inflected can speak volumes. This particular morning, the comment, really, conveyed something like this. As parents, you would be sinking to an all-time low if you cannot muster the time and energy to get a tree which we can all decorate as a family, as is the custom of our people. So I left that staff meeting believing that I simply cannot be too busy not to buy a Christmas tree. I found a tree lot, and after I paid a king's ransom for the tree, but you know, you can't put a price on domestic peace. I then realized that I'd locked my keys in the Subaru. But you know, actually that was just fine because it's not like I had anything else I needed to do that afternoon, and I can hardly think of a better way to spend $120 at Christmas than to a locksmith. So you might think that's wasted money. I like to think of it as investing money to fortify my already considerable obsessive compulsive key checking ritual when I get out of my car. And apparently my vigilance was off at that moment. I want to show you something here. This is, you know, my MERS, my man bag. It goes everywhere I do, so. Okay, so this is the deal. And these are my keys, because this car used to be my wife's. You know, it's an orange plastic tennis racket. Because that, she said, when I asked her why, she said, because you can't lose them in your purse. And I thought, well, it's pretty cool. So I have quite a little ritual here, and getting those that bill has only fortified it. So here's my ritual. When I get out, I put my keys in the same pocket of my MERS right there, and then 3 seconds later, I stick my hand in there to jiggle them and feel them. Then another 5 seconds goes by, and I actually have to look in the bag, because maybe what I'm feeling is some other orange plastic thing shaped like a tennis racket that isn't my key ring. So this is what I do just to get out of the car. Being too busy to buy a Christmas tree or waiting in the bitter cold for a locksmith to show up, these are, as we've heard a lot in 2012, these are first world problems. While I really do want peace in my inmost being and to live at a sustainable pace, the peace I want the most is the shalom the prophet Isaiah said would be for the first, second, and third world through an extraordinary child born of a virgin in Isaiah 9. He writes, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end." Now imagine for some of us hearing the phrase "of the increase of his government, there will be no end" sounds like proof that Jesus is a Democrat. "Of the increase of his government, there will be no end." Well, it actually refers not to the size of the administration, but to the span of care that Christ as Lord would have for the whole world and not just a particular tribe in the Mideast. increase of his government, it would be without end. Isaiah refers to Jesus as the Prince of Peace, but it may be a little more helpful, especially since we're somewhat familiar with the word, to just call him what they say in Hebrew, the Prince of Shalom. To our ears, peace can sometimes sound just like the absence of war, but the Hebrew word shalom is much more comprehensive than that. It means a deep-rooted connectedness between people and between people and God. Shalom is the sense of well-being within and among people where love abounds. It's so much more than just the cessation of war. It's when things come together as they were meant. At staff meeting, it was this shalom that I was saying I wanted. A piece that was noticeably missing one recent morning when I was at the county courthouse with a friend who's gotten in trouble with the law. I was in a very full courtroom the week before Christmas with a lot of people whose lives were greatly complicated by a string of bad choices. I'm guessing that a lot of these folks, like my friend, did not grow up around much peace in their home. I don't think they got a lot of love and nurture along the way. I did not get the sense that I was in a room full of people who knew that God is not like Santa, making a list, checking it twice, gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Many of the people that morning had been busted, and more than once. And if God's love is based on Santa's system, then these folks aren't getting much. The room, to me, felt heavy for a lack of shalom. It wasn't a place just for people who'd broken the law. The room felt heavy with people whose spirits had been broken. Everywhere I looked, I don't even know the stories, but it felt like there's generations of brokenness. I wanted so badly for everyone there to know his or her noble worth as a child, greatly loved by God. Come, Prince of Peace, increase your government, stretch your span of care. It's still needed. At staff meeting, I was saying, I want the peace that was shattered at Sandy Hook Elementary School last week in Newton, Connecticut. This tragedy made me think back to the time in the Gospel of Matthew where we read that King Herod was so threatened by the birth of Jesus, the baby, that he had all the baby boys of Bethlehem, 2 years old and younger, slaughtered. As it is now, so it was then that parents wept uncontrollably and could not be comforted. They must have asked, as we do, in light of an especially brutal year, what on earth is going on? You know, what is wrong with people? It's forcing a lot of us, individually and collectively, to ask some big, hairy questions. One of my sons is an art teacher in Jeffco. This past Monday, one of his sixth graders told him that she'd heard on the news that there was a teacher at Sandy Hook Elementary who was guarding her students by standing in front of the door of the closet where they were hiding. And she was shot trying to protect them. The student then asked my son, "Would you do that for us?" You know, a lot can go through your head when you've got a life or death question being asked, or you're facing a life and death situation. Chris has a beautiful wife and two little children who love him and need him. But I'm very proud of him for answering his fearful student well, assuring her that he would stand between them and harm's way. She returned to her seat for a little while, And then she just couldn't stand it any longer. She came running back up to give him a big hug. What on earth is going on? What is wrong with people? Well, there certainly are some notoriously damaged people who can do horrendous harm. And then there is the hurt and the harm that those of us who may be less wounded are capable of dishing out when our selfish selves are calling the shots. But Jesus, the Prince of Shalom, had a revolutionary way to respond to the evil that came his way, and it did. He did not respond with a heightened sense of fear, though there was much which to be afraid. But that's not how he chose to respond. He didn't respond with a heightened sense of fear and a vigilance to protect himself. Rather, he responded with an expansive love to stand in harm's way and protect others. He said and did the crazy things he taught on the Sermon on the Mount. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. This is not an easy Christmas to be merely nostalgic and ignore how badly we need the peace our Prince must bring to us and through us. In the Gospel of John, chapter 15, the Prince of Shalom summed it up for us, saying, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. Christ was born for this kind of love. We were born to follow in it. That's the talk he walked, and that is the way of Jesus and the way for all who would follow him. Let's pray together. Lord our God, it's times like these when, in the midst of a holiday that is so fun and so festive, that we remember that actions have consequences, and you're leaving all the divine prerogatives and comfort of heaven to come and bear our flesh and to enter this world in the humiliation of a two-celled zygote that finally, you know, develops into an embryo and then is finally burst into this world. The consequences of that whole process for you is a hope for this world that we would not have known otherwise. That there is a way to expand and increase the love of the world rather than the hate that is in it. And so we pray, Lord God, that our Christmas would be, there's a certain sobriety about it this year, but it's also the source of the deepest kind of joy. That Christmas isn't just about help me forget the rest of the things going on in the world, but Christmas is so that I can maybe help change the world as you change us. So hear our prayer, we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome now to this table. Some of us know it as communion, some of us know it as the Eucharist. At Highlands Church, this meal is open for everyone. Kids and adults, anyone can come to this table with us. And we're remembering tonight. 33 years after his humble birth, on the night Jesus was betrayed, he had a meal with his friends, the disciples. And at the end of that meal, he took a loaf of bread, and he gave thanks for that bread, and then he broke it. And he said to his friends, this is my body broken for you and for all the world. Whenever you eat this, do so in remembrance of me. Later, he took a cup of wine, and he said to his friends, "This is the cup of my blood, the cup that is a new covenant, a new relationship is now available for every human being with God. Whenever you drink this, remember me." Communion servers, if you'll come forward now and get ready to serve the meal. The way it works at Highlands Church is pretty simple. There will be 7 stations where folks will be to serve us, and you can take a piece of bread from them or a gluten-free cracker if you prefer, and then you can take that and dip it into the cup, which is juice here at Highlands Church. And you'll know when they're ready, and you can come forward at that point. If this remembrance, this ritual is meaningful for you, we hope that you'll come. But if for some reason it isn't, we have other ways that you can participate right now. Right here is our reflection table, and there are books, little notebooks that you can either write in or read from. There are words of thanksgiving and words of prayer there. Normally we have candles we can light, but here at the high school we can't light candles. So we have this creative idea where there are some papers laid out and some watercolors and eyedroppers, and you can use that to sort of offer up a communal symbol of prayer, either for somebody you love or somebody you miss or some situation in your life. So you can come to that reflection table, or if you prefer, you can stay in your seat and just kind of watch this unfold and listen to our quartet as they play. There are no hoops that you have to jump through to come to communion here. You're welcome if you want to come. And there's only good news to receive at this meal. The good news that the peace of Christ is with us all. Christ who was born into our world. Christ who lived among us as one of us. Christ who died on the cross for all of us and rose from the dead. And Christ who is coming again. It's good news. I hope that you'll come to the table with us.